Yotam Ottolenghi, and I just want to take a survey. How many of you have made an Ottolenghi recipe? Excellent, that's amazing. We're actually at 100%. I like it. This is great. So maybe you've had this experience. It's one that I have. I cook out of his books all the time. And even though I know better, I still kind of have this feeling sometimes. I go to make a recipe for the first time, and I'm making it, and I'm committed, and I'm thinking, has he pushed this envelope too far? There's turmeric, black sesame seeds, and Parmesan together in a cauliflower recipe. Not so sure. Soba noodles, eggplant, and mango? But it all works. As your anxiety grows, you wonder, is this the day? Is this the day you're going to make an Ottolenghi recipe that doesn't work? And no, because without fail, you sit down and you're eating something spectacular and unexpected. It's a party in your mouth, and you know, you're just so in awe of his talent, and it grows and grows and grows. And Yotam is an amazing chef, an amazing cookbook author, and he's really an amazing person. He's truly one of the warmest, kindest, and most brilliant people I've ever had the pleasure of presenting. He owns an empire of spectacular restaurants in London, hosts wonderful shows for the BBC, traveling all around the Mediterranean, and is the author, as we all know, of Ottolenghi the Cookbook, Plenty and Jerusalem. He is here tonight to celebrate his newest book, Pleny More, sure to be your next favorite cookbook. Pleny More is brilliantly organized by cooking method, from ones you would think of, like steamed, braised, and roasted, to the ones you maybe don't, like tossed, cracked, and blanched. I'm not sure if that was supposed to say cracked. It's terrible. Terrible. All right. I don't. Yes, cracked. That was right. Like all of Yotam's books, this one is filled with brilliant combinations you would never think of yourself. There's a tomato and pomegranate salad in here that will knock your socks off. And as always, there are plenty of eggplant recipes. Yotam is joined in conversation tonight by one of our favorite interviewers, the Peabody and Emmy Award-winning documentarian and producer Peter Stein. So please join me to welcome Yotam Ottolenghi and Peter Stein.
That's Yotam, the handsome one. Welcome back to the Bay Area, Yotam.
Thank you. It's great to be here.
Jordan, thank you for those beautiful words.
Yeah, now I have to be really charming.
Oh, fake it, Yotam, fake it. It's so terrific to, first for me to get a chance to meet you, because like Jordan, I have enjoyed experimenting with your recipes, and your new book is chock full of extraordinary flavors and combinations. Parochially, I do want to say, apparently the last time you were here in San Francisco, the Giants were also in the World Series. Yeah.
They won.
We want to have you back every year. And in fact, let's see, January is the Super Bowl. May is the Stanley Cup Finals. Okay, we got you. Have to have you scheduled. Thank you all for giving up your Giants Royals experience. We'll say nothing about what is going on. Some of you may be taping. But this is so not only an adult experience for you coming back to the Bay Area. I was so tickled to learn that when you were 10 years old, your parents, who were both academics, I guess your dad is a mathematician and
chemist,
and
my grandfather. So you're not getting it so wrong.
In the hard sciences, and your mother and an educator, yes, they spent a sabbatical year when you were 10 years old,
yeah.
And they came to.
I landed from the Middle East to Mill Valley, California, in 1977, and I was delighted to see color TV for the first time in my life, and a lot of other things that got me super excited. I really have very fond memories of the city and the Bay Area, and it's remarkable because I've really only spent a year here, but it was a very crucial year. I loved it. I went to school here. I learned English. Israel was very different than to the country that it is today. It really felt like coming from the third world to the first world, and I had the time of my life.
You're only 10 years old, so I don't know what your palate already was like, or whether you even can remember if you experienced so when I, what at the time
when I,
was.
When I did my, I knew my multiplication chart, mm-hmm. 12 by 12, times 12, I got ice cream from the teacher. She got me ice cream. And this never happened in a school in Israel, that you got ice cream. And that was a real culinary highlight. And there was tons more. I mean, we used to go to Fisherman's Wharf and eat shrimps and fried seafood from a newspaper cone. And I will never forget that. It was just fantastic. You can't get seafood, or you couldn't in Israel when I was growing up. So that was kind of really special.
That's I'm sure.
And not kosher.
Yeah. Not at all. Well, being a San Francisco native, I always thought that, in fact, cracked crab was Shabbos dinner. sorry. I still appreciate it. Good Shabbos to all of you. I hope you enjoyed your cracked crab tonight. So, as a 10-year-old, you're experiencing new culinary experiences in San Francisco or in the Bay Area. But I'm curious, because you've really helped popularize and really have lifted not just vegetable cooking but Mediterranean flavors to new and unusual heights in your cooking. Where do you trace developing your palate? What are your deep taste memories, and have they evolved as you've grown?
I was very fortunate because I grew up in an environment that I think now people take for granted a bit more, but it wasn't the case, you know, 40 years ago when I was a child, extraordinary mix of food cultures and influences in the 70s and 80s in Jerusalem. And there was, at home, we had, European, my parents are all from European traditions, my mom's from a German background and my dad's from Italian background. And you can imagine we had really great food, and they both loved to cook. But out in the street, it was the heart of the Middle East, you know, with all the wonderful markets with the vegetables and the spices and the local restaurants, the Palestinian restaurants that are so fantastic. So it was kind of the best of all worlds, and I think this was a really good starting point for someone like me. I could really taste so much, and there was so much going on, and particularly. It's funny now because my cooking cannot be more remote than from Italian cooking. Mm-hmm. My dad is secretly, he would never say that because he's too nice, but he secretly thinks I use way too many ingredients. he always says that's very delicious, but I think he would have rather had like about half or one third of the ingredients of what the ones I've added. So it's a very different way of thinking. But you know, it's fantastic food, and these are fantastic food cultures. But I was one point with I was really lucky because there were not a lot of kids from Jewish Italian background. It's kind of a little bit unusual, and we used to have at school these days where children used to bring the food of their diaspora. Mm-hmm. And so, you know, I was so popular because all the kids with the gefilte fish would come to my pizza, and that was kind of, can you imagine how popular I was on those days?
So was your dad the primary cook in the house growing up?
Both cooked. Mm-hmm. Both my parents cooked, and they still do, and they did a great job because they're pretty adventurous in their cooking, both of them. So we really had kind of lots of everything, really really delicious. I feel quite almost embarrassed to say, but we had really great food all the time.
Yeah, the pangs of jealousy are out there for all of us. Even so, obviously your parents are tremendously proud of your career and so forth. I can only imagine that coming from fairly serious, intellectual, career-driven family as yours is, that your choice to cook for a living wasn't necessarily popular.
No. It didn't go down too well with my dad. And I think the problem was that it's two very different generations, and my father in particular was worried that I'm ditching an academic career in favor of something that is very dubious. And
share with us what you were.
I was studying at the university in Tel Aviv, literature and philosophy, and I was on my way to do a PhD, and I was working at the university as well. And it never crossed his mind that I would not become an academic. Mm-hmm. And I think it never crossed my mind until a certain age that I'm not going to become an academic. But there came a point where I felt very, that it wasn't really my choice. And if I had to choose, I might have not chosen that. And I felt almost burdened by the intensity of the commitment in university. And I came to London and did a few courses at a culinary school, and it was.
Did you tell your parents you were doing that?
Yeah, I told my dad. I sent my parents my dissertation, and in it was a letter. and in the letter it said, this was before emails, and in the letter it said that. Here's what I've done, and that's my work, and it was a really respectable dissertation on a serious subject. But now I'm taking a gap year, and I'm going to go to culinary school. And my dad called me like 5 minutes after he got the thing, and he said, "Are you sure you're doing the right thing?" But he's a very gentle, nice person, so he didn't really get into conflict with me. But I think deep down inside, he was very worried. So I just went on and did it. But I think, and then when I turned 40, on my birthday, everybody stood up to wish me things for the future, and he said, "I just want to wish you that you never listen to my advice again." and that was really lovely, and a good kind of closure.
Closure. Yeah. He sounds like a very loving man.
He is.
Even if he doesn't like all the ingredients that you put into your dishes. But is there a connection for you now looking back between your interest in cooking and your interest in ideas, philosophy, literature, that I read, I think your dissertation was something about the photographic image, which, if anything, you have helped popularize culinary photography in your books. Or was it really a departure, like a different side of your brain that you were exercising in front of the stove or at the pastry counter?
Initially, yes. I would say that I felt, like I said, I think I used the word liberated. It did feel like I'm doing something completely different. In actual fact, it was really nice to use my hands and not use my mind. Mm-hmm. And that's the way I felt about it for quite a long time. But when I started writing books, everything changed again, because I ended up, you know, doing the stuff that I left behind, you know, thinking about what I was doing, trying to understand what it is, how I work, what I do. So try to put names to thoughts and to procedures, which was a little bit more like what I did when I was studying philosophy. So in the end, I went through a whole circle and came back to doing quite a lot of what I did before.
Right.
But now the subject matter is more, I feel closer to it now than I did to what I did at university.
Well, I noticed with this newest book, it's again concentrating on vegetable cookery, but the flavor profiles, I guess, have started to get, depart from the Mediterranean and Middle Eastern and move slightly eastward,
yes.
Iran and India and South Asia. Tell me about how you discovered that, how intentional is that? Is that just where are you, is your palate restless the way other people might be restless about the kind of writing that you
do? Yeah, it is restless, and some of it is because I want to, and some of it is because I have to. And when I say I have to, I only understood it a few months ago when I call it being the victim of my own success, that in a sense, there is a certain expectation from my recipes, and we were trying a piece.
What would you unpack that? What is that expectation?
I will unpack it with an example. We were cooking pea soup in the test kitchen. It was the spring, and it was a delicious pea soup, and we wanted to keep all the vibrancy of the red. So you know, we chilled the peas very quickly, and it was fantastic. And everybody tasted it, and they said, "Oh, that's marvelous." But then someone said, because I've got a little team now working together on recipe testing, someone said, "But it's not very Ottolenghi." And then it dawned on me, and actually I think I knew it before, but I could put word to it, that actually there is a certain expectation from recipes, and I cannot ever go back to cooking anything that doesn't have that kind of wow intensity of, you know, you know, very strong flavors. And it, sometimes it's a problem. So I embrace it now. That's kind of what I do. I do the wow factor recipies.
So how did the pea soup recipe change?
The pea soup recipe ended up being having certain flavored croutons. We tore some bits of bread, and I added a tiny bit of water to them, and then we tossed them in a mix of spices. Because they were wet, they could absorb them, and then we roasted them in the oven. And there was one other thing. You know, I couldn't just have a crouton. It wasn't enough. But I think a couple of other little things.
So you've described your a little bit. You've got a test kitchen now. It's like a full-time lab. This is to feed new books, and you still are doing your column for the. Do you still do the vegetable?
The Guardian.
For the Guardian. And is it still? It's still a vegetable.
It's not vegetarian anymore, but it's still very vegetable focused because that's what I like doing. And there's many vegetarian vegan recipes, but there's also meat and other animals.
They allow you to introduce
they have
meat
yeah
every
they've
so
expanded
often.
My expanded my remit. I'm allowed to cook with meat now. I wasn't allowed for many years.
Can you tell the story of your first column?
Yes, I got many people were angered that the non-vegetarian got to write the vegetarian column for the Guardian. We're talking about the days where, or it's still somehow a little, sometimes a little bit like that, that vegetarianism was a religion or a cult. And if it wasn't one of us, how could it be that someone got to write the vegetarian columns? And that wasn't the initial reaction, but I made it much worse when at my maybe column two or three that I made some kind of summery salad. I suggested to serve it with lamb chops from the barbecue, and my editor didn't notice, and it was a disaster. I mean, the amount of emails that I got, and then the Vegetarian Society debated whether they're allowed to publish my recipe in their magazine, even if they are vegetarian. They were really angry at me, so. That is kind of how I started my world of my engagement with vegetarianism. But I have to say that I think the world has really changed since then, and it doesn't feel like this anymore. It feels like many carnivores and omnivores are very happy to eat way more vegetables than they used to, and they're really kind of putting their heart in it. It's not like it used to be like some limp old bean sitting on the side of the plate, all gray and overcooked. All of a sudden, like the serious chefs, you know, not like me, but the ones that have stars and all the rest, they put vegetables on their menus at the top, and not in California, that has always been miles ahead of the rest of the world, but in London, in Paris, in New York. I mean, those are places where all of a sudden you go to a Michelin star restaurant, and it's like the first few dishes are all vegetables. And this is like was unthinkable at 10 or 15 years ago, and it's a marvelous thing.
I guess it must be partly people's understanding about diet as well as sustainability, how difficult it is to live sustainably with a heavy meat diet. But it's also about flavor, yes? I mean,
yes.
You have an extraordinary bounty with vegetables, which is what you've gotten to explore
this
here.
This is the point that I was trying to make in the introduction to the book, because I think what it was, when I started to write vegetarian recipes for The Guardian, I thought that I will kind of exhaust my ideas after about 10 weeks. You know, I thought, how many vegetarian recipes can I actually come up with that are applicable and usable for home cooks and exciting? And that you were asking me before about the moving east, and I actually forgot to address that.
I forgot to remind you to address that, so thank you.
But I think one of the things that I discovered over the last few years, and that has a lot to do with traveling, because I realized that, in a sense, I started off from the heart of the Middle East, from Jerusalem, and then with time, through travels and reading and coming into contact with cooks, I realized that it kind of makes sense to move north and east to Turkey, to Persia, to Iraq, to India, and to Southeast Asia. And every step that I'm taking makes complete sense to me. For currently, especially in this book, I'm engaged with the wonderful cuisine of Iran, the Persian cooking, which is one of the richest food cultures there is. Not totally explored yet in the West, I don't think, but really kind of people are starting to understand. And if you have... there aren't any very good, many good Iranian restaurants, but all the good cooking is done at home. So if you have an Iranian friend, just grab onto them and make them cook for you, because they do make the most wonderful home food, like nothing else. And the Iranians are the champions of rice cooking, and I'm saying that like they beat the Japanese and everybody else. They make the best rice.
And in what way? Like what makes?
Because there is this process that involves parboiling, mm-hmm. and then allowing the rice to cook in its own steam, it makes it for long grain rice. Let's like narrow it down a little bit. It's the best thing you can do with it, because every grain is separate, and the flavors kind of evolve very slowly over time if they put some stuff on the bottom. So it is really the most wonderful way to cook rice, and also obviously the famous tadiks, the crusty bottom, which is, you know, everybody loves so much. So this is a cuisine that really makes complete sense to me to move on to, because these are very similar ingredients to the ones we use in Palestinian and Israeli cooking, but taken one step further. So every time I discover a cuisine like that, I think like, oh my God, I've kind of won the lottery. There's a little bit more of what I was doing before, and that's how I like to move around.
So what your skill is, I think, though, in particular, is not just discovering and writing about these traditional cuisines, but also kind of doing these mashups, these contemporary incursions that allow one or two twists to make something new out of, let's say, as Jordan mentioned in her introduction, I think it's the first recipe in the new book, this tomato and pomegranate salad, which I made the other day because we're lucky we're in the shoulder season right now in the Bay Area. We have still great late summer, early fall tomatoes, and wow, pomegranate. So I thought, okay, I'm gonna make this delicious salad. And of course, I have to go down to the Middle Eastern market to find the pomegranate molasses. And I'm shaking my hand saying, that Ottolenghi is making me go out of
the way. I'm surprised you don't have it in your larder already. I'm
confessions. It doesn't go with cracked crab. And so I'm. But all by way of asking, how careful are you to, or do you care if you are pulling up or introducing what we might think of as difficult to find, or I don't want to use the word exotic, because they're not exotic in the cultures that they come from, but for typical Western pantries and larders, ingredients that aren't normally found.
So the first part of the question is putting together things like, you know, pushing the envelope with the recipes. And I take quite a lot of care when I do this, because I also have great respect for old food traditions. I think I have gotten myself into a lot of trouble recently with a hummus debate with a very beloved British food cookery writer, whom name I'm not going to, I won't mention, who added yogurt to her hummus, and I got really upset, and I said something in an interview, and then the Daily Mail wrote that I attacked her, that's more about British journalism than about hummus, but. what I'm saying is that there is certain things that I find it very difficult to meddle with, and I would never dare try to change a traditional recipe that's been perfected over centuries, because I've got all the respect in the world for that. But I do like to borrow in a very kind of incremental way, the way I described to you, and add to a kind of in a modern context or in a current context ingredients. Like, so if I, let's just give a few examples from Persian cooking, the ingredients that I haven't maybe used 5 or 10 years ago, like barberries and dried limes, those are things that I think are easily incorporated into our daily cooking. I think it's kind of kosher to do that. You know, you can do that. There's certain things that I would never try to change. I mean, I would never try to turn things on their heads completely and do, you know, there's a lot, like I'll go back to what I feel like I've got the authority to talk about a little bit, is hummus. And, you know, I can't stand all the beetroot hummus and this hummus and that hummus, because for me that's just not what it is, call it a spread or a paste. But if it was someone else's food, I would say, like, who cares, you know? But, you know, so everybody has things that are very close to their heart, and you need to respect that.
Did your one of the books that you co-authored with your business partner and friend Sami Tamimi is the Jerusalem cookbook, and I'm wondering how many here have actually thrown like Jerusalem cookbook parties. I know a lot of you have. It's a tremendous book. But I'm curious, two Jerusalemites, do you argue about what hummus is? Or should
Sami
like?
And I?
Yes.
We are kind of, funnily enough, we don't really argue that much. We tend to agree. We have similar palates, and we've been working together for many years, and we're very close friends. And no, we don't argue. We kind of, Sami is a bit more reserved with his use of ingredients than I am, so he's a bit closer to my dad's camp, but still, well, maybe somewhere in the middle. But all in all, we kind of see eye to eye on most things, and as much as we like to get into debates or fights, but we never get a chance to do that.
So Sami is one of your team now that's developing recipes. Take us through the process of how you develop a recipe.
So just I want to clarify, Sami is not part of the team. The way Sami and I work together now is that because there was the business was growing and the books are coming out and there's just a lot to do, we've separated a little bit the way we operate in the last few years. I've got the test kitchen, which is really mostly geared towards publication of books and recipes and playing around and fooling around with recipes. And Sami is in charge of the kitchens, and he trains the chefs and works with them, etc. And we meet about once or twice a week and exchange ideas, because the recipes that we publish in the books are not really always suitable for restaurants and vice versa. So we created this separation, which works very well for us, but it allows quite a lot of creativity to be going in different directions, so that's our system. But in terms of the test kitchen, now we have a little team of about two people plus me, and we test recipes together. First of all, it allows us to test more recipes, allows me to do less chopping and washing up than I used to do, and it's also a great way to create, because we bounce off each other and we come up with new ideas. And I find that it's really changed the way I think about food. There's always, at the end of every cooking session, there's always a tasting and a kind of a robust discussion. We get into real serious discussions about the food, up to that, to the eighth of a teaspoon of something. And it's really exciting to do, but I think it also works in terms of the recipe, because we kind of turn them on the head a million times before we actually put them to paper and publish them.
You organized this book, as I think Jordan mentioned in her introduction, by technique of how you treat the vegetables: raw, tossed, braised, cracked. There is
cracked is the eggs. Yeah, I just wanted to make this clear. It's actually the only recipe that's not a cooking technique. It's just, but all the rest, that's true.
Why by technique rather than by food group or
It goes to what I was saying earlier, and I think that we have kind of grown up, everybody, quite a lot with our relationship with vegetables. And I think many people, I'm sure many in this room, would be able to tell you the difference between a kohlrabi and a celeriac and a Swede and a turnip. A Swede is rutabaga, and
thank you for that.
and I feel there's a certain amount of maturity when it comes to vegetables now, and I wanted to draw the attention to a different aspect, and that's how we cook our vegetables, which I think is very important. I mean, obviously, I cook them in plenty and I cook them here, but in terms of how the vegetables, how I look at them, I try to get to understand what is the kind of versatility of vegetables that we sometimes overlook, and that has to do with the way we treat them and cook them. And I also try to redress the balance between vegetables and meat, because I think, in my opinion, there is a general understanding and respect to ways of cooking meat. You know, if you make a steak, you use the prime cuts, and if you are using the cheaper cuts, you're gonna make a stew.
And
also when you go to a restaurant, they ask you how you want your meat done, if it's a burger or a steak or whatever it is, and you tell them, and if it's not good, you send it back. And with vegetables, that doesn't exist. And I made this joke a couple of times before. I'll make it again. You don't return your cauliflower if it's overcooked. And
are you going to start a new trend? The restaurateurs are now shaking in their boots. They sent back the cauliflower.
Yeah, or at least ask me how I want my cauliflower done. We're taking this to an extreme, but I think it is very much the case that vegetables are much more versatile than we give them credit for, and you can achieve a lot by taking one vegetable, cauliflower for instance, and grilling it or steaming it or roasting it or deep frying it or shallow frying it or char grilling it. I mean, they're all ways of taking one thing and turning it into something else. And in a sense, cauliflower is much more versatile than a steak, because you can do many more things to it and it will be more forgiving. So that's what I was trying to do, and that's the kind of message, just to allow people to be a little bit less one-track minded when it comes to cooking vegetables and understand this versatility.
You have such an amazing palate, but I am curious, you're also human. Is there a...
makes you think that?
Is there a flavor, either vegetable or from the world of the animal kingdom, that you don't like? Or is that a failure of some palate imagination to have not? You
know? No, I do like almost everything. I like some things more than I like others. So I like cauliflower more than a broccoli. I know that's very controversial. That's going to be in the Daily Mail tomorrow. But
the Broccoli Council is filing a lawsuit as we speak.
And I can't eat durian. It's a smelly, stinky fruit from Southeast Asia. But I think there is no such thing as a vegetable that's not delicious, because of what goes to what I said to you earlier. Even something which is relatively I don't want to hurt broccoli fans across the land, but it's not for me. It doesn't have the best flavor or texture. But even if you char grill it properly and add a nice infusion of oil and some anchovies, like you know the Italian way, it's fantastic. It's delicious. So I don't see a point not liking any vegetable.
You've also been really imaginative in embracing, as we talked briefly earlier, new ingredients or exotic ingredients or ingredients that are simply new to your palate. You talked about barberries and Iranian cuisine. Yeah. Are there any other sort of discoveries? And I kind of want this to move a little bit into this notion of food trends or food fads, because as in the culinary world that we live in the Bay Area, you know, we're all trying to keep up with the latest cuisine and restaurant and mashup and pop-up, and sort of sometimes I resent the fact of I've heard about verjuice now, and I don't know what it is, and I champion it in the book.
Yeah.
I know. So tell us about new ingredients and the problem of the fad.
First of all, I want to address the second bit of the question, because I think there is a problem, because people start becoming very anxious and they associate food with anxiety, and that's not a good thing. Cooking is very, and eating is a very sensual experience, and that's what I discovered when I moved from academia to cooking. And going back to, and adding an element of anxiety is not very helpful. And I think people, the kind of the dinner party circuit, are really quite an anxious lot, because they're always trying to outmaneuver their friend with a new ingredient or a new cuisine. And I'm saying that, I know it's not good for my book sales, but I really believe that people should just chill out a little bit, and not people want to cook, they haven't even finished mastering the food of Thailand and they're already moving to Burma, you know. it's like seriously, but I feel very strongly about that you really don't need to have that anxiety in your daily life. So I have some friends that invite me to dinner parties, and the best people I like going to is the ones that cook more or less the same thing every time, because you know you're going to get something delicious that was tried and tested, and that cook is kind of famous for it, like it used to be, and I find that a little bit more helpful than just the whole new thing every time. So that's about anxiety. Having said that, there's some wonderful ingredients that I do like championing and discovering and showing people. And some of the ingredients that I do love at the moment are the ones that we mentioned from Iran. Another one that comes from that part of the world is kashk, which is kashk or kishk. It's probably most of you have not heard about it. I'm quite new to it. It's a fermented yogurt that's been allowed to dry. And when you go in Jerusalem in the Old City, sometimes you see in the shops these balls of white rocks. They look like white rocks. I always actually thought it was soap. And and actually it's dried yogurt. And because you know when there was a season, there used to be a season for milk. And so they'd make the yogurt all around in Turkey, Iran, Palestine, and then allow it to dry in the sun, sometimes with barley, sometimes with wheat. And as it would dry, it would ferment. And then when it's completely dry, they'd make it into balls or keep it in as powder. And then when the time comes to use it, you rehydrate it with a bit of water. And it's got a wonderful flavor. It's a bit like kind of a really mature Parmesan from the process. And I've been using it. It's very hard to get. In London, we get it from Persian shops in jars, rehydrated already. It's very nice. As a substitute, I mix Parmesan, feta, and sour cream. And that kind of flavor combination reminds me of that.
And you use it as an additional ingredient in what kinds of dishes?
So, for instance, it's a really good way to finish stews. Like you could drizzle it on top. You need to warm it up a bit to kill the bacteria. But it goes over. No, I didn't mean that in the way it sounded. That's really good. Also, any context you'd use yogurt and cheese, it comes in handy. Okay. We even had a dish at Nopi in one of my restaurants of raw beef with that kind of drizzled on top, like a kind of a tartar.
Wow. I didn't mean to denigrate verjuice, which is an amazing ingredient. It's what makes Dijon mustard taste different from German kind of mustard. Mm-hmm. But tell us a little bit about what verjuice is, because you do champion
it. Verjuice is actually a very old ingredient. Essentially, it's the juice of unripe grapes, and I think it's probably older than most of the condiments we've discussed so far. It's been around forever, but it was very popular in France in particular. It is still popular. It's used instead of vinegar. It's not quite as harsh to finish sauces, and it's been popularized recently by Australian cook called Maggie Beers, and she has her line of verjuice and sells it all over the world. And it's a really good ingredient. I use it. I reduce it quite a lot and add it to dressings. And when you reduce it, you get more sweetness and more acidity, a little bit like pomegranate molasses. Not really, but in kind of that family of flavors. And it's good for dressings. It's good for marinades. It's good to finish off sauces and stews and all sorts of wonderful things.
I love what you said about keeping anxiety out of the kitchen. because in fact, I mean, I think you're spot on with, we have a wonderful and embracing food culture, but it also sometimes comes with a certain amount of panic around whether you're following the right trends and so forth. Are you personally okay with people when they come up to you say, oh, I made your wonderful recipe, but of course I substituted the oregano for mint and the pomegranate, I didn't have that, so I put in walnut.
Completely.
How?
Yeah. No, it's exactly what I said earlier. I think there is this, almost totalitarian understanding of how things should work. And I think nobody has that kind of knowledge of exactly how you should do it or not should do or shouldn't do things. So I'm very open to that. I do changes like that. If someone feels comfortable to do that, I'm very happy. And in actual fact, my recipes are very long, and they have a long list of ingredients. So if you omit one or two, it's not the end of the world. You know, it's
you heard it here first, folks.
it's still going to taste good, maybe not completely as I wanted it, but quite close. So I'm very happy to give that literary freedom to interpret my recipes as people see right. I am very literal, so when I put the recipe down, I try to allow people to be able to cook it exactly as I did. This is why I go down to the, you know, to the eighth of a teaspoon, etc. But that's because I want people who don't want to improvise to be able to do it and achieve what I achieved. I also don't, when I test my recipes, I never use fancy ingredients. I go to the supermarket and buy actually the cheap version, because I want to make sure that if someone does that, they're still going to get a reasonably good result.
So this brings up something important, because supermarkets, at least in the U.S., some of them are notorious for sourcing their produce from all over. If it's, you know, if it's winter and you want blueberries, you're going to get them because they're grown in Argentina. And
yeah,
can you talk a little bit about the tension between having a very bright and lively and diverse set of ingredients and flavors in your cooking versus local and sustainable agriculture?
There's no contradiction, really, in my mind. I mean, in my restaurants, we source our ingredients, in what I call locally, would be, you know, Britain, maybe France, which is, as you know, certain parts of France are as close as Scotland is, or Europe in general. I call it local, but we do try to use things seasonally, and I think it makes sense because it's more delicious to use things in season. And it pains me to see when you go to a supermarket and you get this asparagus from Peru throughout the year. Peru is further away from us than it is from you, but it's probably the same here. And I don't get it. And I don't enjoy it. But bringing all these ingredients that I'm talking about, it's got nothing to do with that. I mean, those are ingredients that you could grow in some places, and spices have always been traded and transferred all across the world. And I think using, you know, localism is a good thing in general, but it kind of makes sense to not go to the extreme also with that, because I know that a lot of restaurants in London, for instance, try to grow their own produce on their roofs and little gardens and allotments and this and that, and I've got a lot of sympathy for that. But sometimes either it comes at a price. You know, it's way more wasteful to grow those, you know, five leaves or whatever on your roof than it would to bring it from a farm in Devon. You know, it's a tokenism. So you need to kind of take it with a pinch of salt. How far you're going to take that idea of locality and whether it's practical to actually practice it. So, when I'm here in California, we're talking about a completely different world, because you've got the weather and you've got the land. And we're talking about a tiny rainy island that doesn't really, not much grows on. So we have to make the best out of what we can.
Do you, in fact, I mean, I know you're on a book tour now. You probably don't have much time here. But if you had your druthers, would you spend time in the Bay Area to take a look at food trends or go to restaurants that you have heard about?
This is the worst book tour I've been to, because I've got only one night in San Francisco. And it's painful for me too. But so I won't be able to go and try all the new restaurants that I want to go and have. But every time I go to the Mission and I go all around San Francisco and I eat everywhere I can. And I won't get to do it this time, but I will be back.
Yeah, good. Speaking of restaurants, you now are you have a multifaceted empire, really. You're publishing, you're writing, you're delis and restaurants. And here in the Bay Area, something has come up recently where chefs and restaurants are really decrying the shortage of chefs. Cost of living is extremely high in the Bay Area, and I'm sure it's also extremely high in London. And even here, I think it was in today's San Francisco Chronicle where we're learning that a few restaurants are deciding to dispense with the notion of tipping in the American custom of somewhere between 15 and 20%, so that they can automatically add a 20% surcharge to their bills, so that they can pay a living wage to all of their employees, including the bussers and the folks who are cooking in the back, and not just the servers. Long way of asking you, what is, do you face some of those same economic challenges in keeping restaurants open in a very, very busy and expensive city like
it's,
London?
Yeah, it's very, very difficult. We have, I mean, housing prices have been really increasing tremendously in the last few years, and I know that cooks that come to, I mean, London is a place where people come and spend a few years and then move on when they're you know, for chefs, that's normally the case, or waiters, and it's a huge problem. They can live, sometimes you get like 6 people or 7 people or 8 people living in one apartment in order to kind of make it work for them, and it's difficult for me as a restaurateur, and also for other people like me. And I know that we are struggling. We're quite fortunate that I think there is a core of staff that stays, but the problem is that with the people, the periphery where people, you know, come and go, and then you do get a lot of problem. And also there's so many types of restaurants now, and so many of them around, then the chefs come and go very quickly. They go and they do their stage for 6 months or a year, and then they move on to the next one. So that turnover doesn't help keep the quality, and it takes a lot. Sammy and I struggle constantly with the quality control. You know, we're constantly checking and tasting and retraining our teams to make sure that it's always good.
For you, at this point in your career, where you've really found that being, in a way, a writer, an educator, a sort of champion of cooking, how important is having a restaurant in the constellation of your activities? Would it be okay for you to close them? I mean, obviously, maybe economically, they're very successful, but when you say that it's hard, it's a hard business to be in.
The restaurants are doing well. And I think all the aspects of what we're doing actually enhance each other. So I think we have it really good. we sell books, and that helps promote the restaurant, and vice versa. So it actually works really well together, hand in hand. I wouldn't think that one comes at the expense of the other, especially because of the way that the company is run. It's a partnership, so it's not just me and Sammy. There's a couple of other acting partners, so each one does their own thing. Mm. So we make sure that it kind of works for us. But they're doing all right.
Okay. So and in fact, it does seem that also in the U.S. that one of the templates for how to keep a sustainable operation going in the food world is to have these multifaceted enterprises where you're doing it.
It's very handy in other respects because we're talking about keeping people. We can move people around. I mean, it doesn't sound so good when I describe it like that, but in a way, you can give your team, your staff, more opportunity for change and diversity in their work. Mm-hmm. So, my test kitchen team are ex-chefs that have, you know, worked for 2, 3, 4 years and have had. They've wanted to move on, and then they join, and we do testing recipes. So it's a wonderful thing to do that is different and a little bit less hard work and more social hours. So that kind of also helps a bit.
Not that you're not busy enough, but I heard you ask the other day on another interview program, so what's next for you? But I was actually very curious about your response, which wasn't definitive, but you mentioned pastry, and I realized that pastry is, in a way, that was one of your real introductions to cooking, that your first culinary education was as a pastry chef. So can you talk a little bit about what you like about working with dough and pastry?
Oh yeah, no, pastry was my first station. My first when I started working in kitchens, I was so underqualified that the chef told me, go and help the pastry chef whip her egg whites, and it was in a French styled restaurant, so there was a lot of souffles. So I was whipping a lot of egg whites, and during service, and it doesn't take a PhD to whip egg whites, and so I did that for a little while. And what happened was that when I moved on to the next job, they asked me, what did you do before? I said I was in the pastry section. So they said, okay, go and work in the pastry section. So I end up working about 4 or 5 years in the pastry section, actually I don't really do this really justice because I love doing it. I had great joy of working in the pastry section. I had so much joy that I've wanted to just stay doing pastries. And I love working with dough. I love the sensuality of it. It's the only section in the kitchen where you really get to massage your food for a very long time. And
how many kale massagers are there out in the audience?
it's fantastic. And I used to make pain au chocolat a lot. Mm-hmm. And there is this, you need to roll your dough and then you pipe your chocolate and it's kind of into these long sausages that you roll on themselves and you need to twist it and get the air out and then roll it and then cut it. And it's really, everybody needs to make this once in their life to really get the whole idea of how wonderful it is to do. And I remember that very clearly, how I enjoy doing that kind of movement. And it's extremely enjoyable, the kneading and the pulling and the rolling and all these kind of wonderful things.
So is there a pastry book in the works?
There is a possible pastry book. We haven't signed a contract with the publisher yet, so I can't say anything. But yeah, no, there will be a pastry book at some point, a sweet book.
Yeah.
Because my passion is there and we've got tons. And Ottolenghi stands for sweets in many people's minds because we have a massive pastry counter that I'm very proud of and we constantly renew and change. And also in this book there is a nice baking or sweet section that I think does kind of different things with sweets.
Well, one last question for me and then I'm excited to hear what our audience has to ask you. And it has to do, in a way, it ties together with pastry and then this other question that we talked about earlier about classic recipes versus improvisation. I think it's in the Jerusalem cookbook where you have a recipe for babka. Babka being one of the great, really like one of the grandma recipes, I would say, the booby recipe. and I'm curious about your approach to that because you obviously have such a great love for pastry. And for those who don't know, babka is, how would you describe babka?
Babka is a yeasted cake from Eastern Europe, and it's there's different types of fillings, but the pastry itself is enriched with oil or butter, and then you roll in nuts or chocolate, or some people do it with cheese, and then you kind of there are different ways to also finish it as well, but the one in Jerusalem is kind of braided and then cut. You see it in lots of Eastern European and Jewish delis across the land.
So I was kind of surprised to see that recipe in the Jerusalem cookbook, only because I kept thinking, how are Yotam and Sami going to Ottolenghi a babka? Because in fact, it is there's a kind of ur sensation of cutting into a warm piece of babka that I didn't want to have a contemporary, you know, sort of flip on it. And in fact, you don't do that.
We don't do a twist, no.
So tell me about that.
Well, the babka, a bit like hummus, you don't play around with it. I have to say something about Israeli cuisine, which is really interesting because what happened, there wasn't such a thing as an Israeli cuisine not too long ago. I mean, there was like the cuisines of all the people that gathered there and there was Palestinian food, but there was never such a thing as an Israeli cuisine. And it's only the last 20 years, actually since I left, that this has actually started, it's got nothing to do with that, that it started to form itself, because Israel is a very young country, and it's very interesting how this is kind of taking shape. And babka, and if people who know Jerusalem know that there's very few recipes from Eastern Europe in the book, and that's not got to do not because of the fact that there isn't Eastern European food in Jerusalem. It's just because Sami and I don't like it so much. So and we say it quite out loud. I mean, that we do love certain things. We love our matzo balls and we love our chopped liver, but we don't like certain other things. And so a babka is really, really delicious. So what I noticed is that what we turned into Israeli food is actually what I call the survival of the fittest, where the best food of every community kind of rises to the surface and becomes part of the
pantheon,
the pantheon of of Israeli cuisine. And that's why the food is so good, because you got the babka, which is probably the best thing that Polish Jews have ever produced. and then you've got this...
Isaac Bashevis-Singer may argue with you on that, but...
And then you've got this hug, which is the chili paste that the Yemeni Jews brought with them, which is like better than sriracha. And then you got the hummus, which is the, you know, from Jews from Arab countries and Palestinian. And so we've got all those things. So the icons of Israeli food are the ones that I don't want to touch because they're so good. But then there are all the others that you can play. Definitely you don't touch a babka.
Great. Well, I'm sure some of you have questions or ideas or recipe hints or kitchen disasters you want to share with us. There's microphones on both sides.
We have microphones on each side. I'm just going to ask you to come out to the aisles and line up to ask your questions. I'll take the first question right here on your left. Hi. Thanks for doing this. So I've heard a lot about bakers and chefs, and my understanding is that bakers traditionally are really precise people who like to measure and make things exactly because that's what makes it turn out perfectly, and that chefs are more improvisational. So it's interesting to hear that you like to do both. Can you comment on your observation of those personality traits and how they manifest in you?
Yeah, I think it's probably true. This stereotype works quite well. And I think that actually works quite well for me too, because I'm very precise, anal. And that's why I think the pastry department suited me for many years. And that's maybe why I'm a recipe tester and not running the kitchens like Sammy, because there is a sense of that precision really helps me. Not only in the kitchen, but we'll focus on that now. And I find it very reassuring that, you know, things could be measured and you can put them down and you know it's going to be there the same the next time. But these are two types of personalities, and cooks are so different from each other. Every cook has their own way of doing it, and each one does it very, very differently. And yeah, I'm definitely on the right side of the scale, and then there's other people on the other side of the scale. But those observations are probably right.
Over here on your right.
Hi. First of all, thank you for your cookbooks. It's been fun trying all the various recipes. My question is, as a tourist to London, which of your restaurants would you recommend? And it may be difficult, just as it would be difficult for me to choose which one of my children I love more.
Exactly.
But if I could only go to one, which would you recommend?
Okay, I mean, so you're an Ottolenghi virgin, and you want me to tell you
Yotam, from finishing that sentence.
I would say if you haven't been to any of the restaurants, you want to go to Ottolenghi in Islington on Upper Street, because it does both the deli. I think that it's nice to see the whole display of food, which is what got us to where we are today. So you would see there, but also the food as it comes from the kitchen, so you get a mixture of a bit of everything.
All right, next question over here.
Hi there. What is your junk food guilty pleasure? What do you hide to eat?
Great question.
I don't do guilt so much.
You're going to have to leave the building, Yotam. we're revoking your card.
I don't have a card. That's quite a serious point. I can eat many things that I can have things that we wouldn't consider appropriate for a vegetable guru, but I can have I have like instant ramen in my cupboard with lots of MSG that if I want to eat something quickly, I pour some boiling water and have that. I don't feel guilty about it. I really enjoy it. You should try it once, but maybe I'll put a recipe for that in one of my books.
There you go.
But I'm not a purist, and I don't live like that. I like to eat everything, and I sometimes would have junk food or a chocolate bar, or a cheap one, or whatever. But I think it's quite important. I don't get really kind of precious about these things, and yeah. That's it. But those instant noodles, I do like them.
On your right?
I was lucky enough in May to go to all four of your outlets. And ooh, the thing that struck me the most is in the delis, the display of the food is so incredible. I mean, it's just right there. So then you come back to the United States, and I've learned now the term is a sneeze guard.
Yeah, sneeze guards.
Do you not, you are not required to have sneeze guards in?
Don't tell them. No, we're fighting this. We have the way it works is that I think England is one of the only countries that allows this for some reason, and we have very strict health and safety rules. But there is a special clause. It's very technical, under which we operate, which is called the hotel and bar and buffet clause, which allows you to put the food out for a little while, up to 3 hours or 2.5 hours without guard for people to help themselves. And that's how we make it work. But it's very, you know, when the food goes out, we take note of the time and the temperature, and then we come every half hour and check it, and we come back, and then it needs to be discarded if it's not there for too long. So it's a controlled risk that we're taking, but you couldn't do it here. But also the weather is quite good for that; it doesn't get very hot, and so we kind of manage to do that, but not with meat or fish or anything dangerous, just with your vegetables, just to reassure everybody. This
next question on your left.
I was just wondering if you've considered opening a restaurant in the U.S. and perhaps maybe the Bay Area.
So I will answer with a story. Forgive the people who've already heard this. But a few years ago, I did a program about the food of Jerusalem for the BBC. And as part of the program, I went to various people's homes and restaurants in Jewish homes and Arab homes and restaurants. And one of the places we visited was a hummus place in the old city that's been around for ages and is kind of a real kind of establishment, Abu Shukri, and both Palestinians and Jews go there and tourists. It's a wonderful place, and it makes delicious hummus. And every day, they make it. And hummus you don't keep for the next day. You just cook it on the day. I'm just telling you all, you know, that's, it's very different from the proposition that we get in supermarkets where there sits in the tab cold. It's kind of something that you cook on the day and you serve, and that's it. And it's a whole meal, and it's a whole ceremony, and it's served with all sorts of toppings. It's something very special. And every day they make the huge vat of hummus, and they serve it until it's finished. And it's run by a father and son. The father is in his 70s, and the son is in his 50s. And every day when the hummus is ready, the son brings the father his spoon, and the father tastes it, and it approves it to go out to the customers. And when I got back and after the show, I spoke to one of my chefs and I said to him, it's ridiculous, like this guy's 50-something and he's still not qualified to send the hummus out without his dad tasting it. Like, what's going on here? Like, when? When is he going to be able to just, you know, say, Dad, forget it, I'm just taking out the hummus today without giving you the bite. And so the guy, who was very cheeky, said to me, well, you know, you're the same. Like, I've been working with you for 8 years, and every day you come and taste the food. What's wrong with you? So you understand where this answer is going, right?
You're opening a hummus restaurant in San Francisco.
Both Sammy and I and the rest of us in the team are very controlling. We taste the food every day, and it would be very difficult to taste the food in the Bay Area if we're in London. So that's the long answer to a short question.
Over here on your right.
Traditionally, chefs are thought to be full-figured because they taste and eat and eat and taste.
Yeah, don't trust the skinny Italian chef. That's the name of a book, right?
What happened to you?
I don't know.
For the radio audience, let the record state that Yotam is trim.
I wasn't aware we have a radio audience, so that's good. I look after myself and I do some exercise and I try to eat in moderation. What happens is that I taste food all day a lot and quite a bit of it. And many cooks and chefs will tell you that somehow it makes you sometimes eat less because you're so overwhelmed by flavors that when you get back home or at the end of the day, you want to eat very little. I want to eat very little. I hardly eat dinner on many nights. So I think that actually I might eat less than your average person, even though I taste things all day. But other chefs are more full-figured. I don't know what they do wrong.
Next question on your left.
Hi. Thank you for being here. I believe that children eat better if their food looks more beautiful. And with three children, I'm wondering, because your books are so magnificent, that possibly could you make a children's cookbook?
And I should add, you have a youngster, a toddler now of your own.
Yeah, I do. Well, I don't think I should do a children's cookbook because I think this is a children's cookbook. I have a little boy, and I'm sure I'm going to get a lot of things from him in the future. He's still not even 2 years old, so I can't kind of say too much at this stage. But I try to give him the food that we eat. I reduce the salt and sugar content and do all that. But in a sense, I think that's the only way, and it works well so far. I mean, he's fussy in some ways already. He likes green things, but doesn't like red things.
Mm. But does he like broccoli?
He likes broccoli, yeah. He likes broccoli, he likes peas, he likes beans, but he doesn't like tomatoes or peppers. Anything red he doesn't like. And that's just the way I see it. I wouldn't want to do a children's book because I would get really kind of bored because I had to tone down all the flavors and do all sorts of things that I don't like doing. So I won't do this one.
Up on your right.
Good evening. Chef, I think you do an amazing job of representing Israeli food. I've been there multiple times and really appreciate what you've done. I've also been to London and eaten your food, made sure I took my wife there, and a lot of our friends are here. We're huge fans, obviously. You mentioned your background of Italian and German, and I was just curious, you also mentioned Eastern European. So how is the Italian and German in you sort of influence your cooking, or what do you think about your schnitzel and your pasta, if you will?
My Italian side, I think I mentioned it's my dad was like a proper Italian cook, so we had a lot of things that are the staples of Italian cooking, polenta and pasta and beautiful grilled vegetables and vinegar and all sorts of wonderful antipasti, I think it's I can't say that it kind of shaped my cooking, but it's definitely given me a good understanding of flavors and how and respect of food and the idea that to put food on a table is something that you think about quite a lot. So that shaped my cooking in a certain way. On my mother's side, it's a bit more complicated because I don't think she was a purist German cook. Neither was my grandmother, her mother. They're very well. They cook really well, but it wasn't kind of loads of cabbage and potatoes. That German side shaped me in one way that they were very. They were very bad Jews. So they ate like. Ham and all sorts of things, and my dad comes from a bit more traditional background, so they wouldn't make their lasagna without cheese and all that kind of stuff because they came from a kosher background, but my mom had to really completely corrupted me, and to the extent that when I had to go, my mom bought her bacon, her ham under the counter in Jerusalem, because you couldn't buy ham, not because it was illegal, but because the Orthodox would come and stone the butcher. So he gave it to her like in a wrapped package under the counter. It's absolutely true. I'm not making this up. And then she would tell me when she put it in my sandwiches for school to tell the other kids that it was turkey. and I did. And for years I took these sandwiches to school, and I had to tell all these kids that this was turkey, but actually it was ham. And I think nobody believed me, but it made my mom feel better that I don't impose this on others, and accidentally they asked for a buy, so I said just don't give them any of it. So this is how the German side affected me. I'm sure that's not the answer you were looking for, but it's a true answer, yeah.
We'll take the last two questions on your left.
So I accidentally discovered you in Notting Hill years ago, and I was attracted by your humongous meringues that you had in the window at the time. And I was wondering what inspired to make meringues the size of small babies' heads.
Oh, that's a terrible metaphor. I met Sammy in a place, wonderful deli patisserie / coffee shop called Baker and Spice that was in Chelsea in London, and I was running the pastry department and Sammy was running the kitchen, and we used to make these big meringues and they were very, very popular, and this is where we got the idea. And the only difference is that they were kind of only white and we added the color, the raspberry and the chocolate and all those and the cinnamon and all the things we add to them. I don't really eat those meringues, but some people love them. I don't know why, because they're so big. I mean, I never quite understand what people do with them when they take them home. But some people are crazy about them, and so we make them. But it also really looks good on the display. It's got a long shelf life.
the last question.
Hi, so if you were stranded somewhere and you had just one meal to have, what would you have?
That's a good last question. I would go back to the Jerusalem cookbook and choose from there, because I always choose that because I think it's a dish that kind of covers a lot of grounds for me personally. It's a mejadra, which is rice and lentils. It's a very modest a set of ingredients, and it's nothing like what people think when you say rice and lentils, because it's got tons of fried onion in it added as well, and you serve it with some full fat yogurt, and it's kind of the perfect balance between being virtuous and being delicious, because it is very good. It's rice and lentils and things that are really good for you, but it's also really, really delicious, and I could eat it all the time from the morning until night, because it's very basic, but it does have nice flavors as well. So that would be what I'd take with me.
Thank you so much.
Thank you, and thank you, Yotam.
There is a thing. What happened was that when I moved on to the next job, they asked me, what did you do before? I said I was in the pastry section. So they said, okay, go and work in the pastry section. So I end up working about 4 or 5 years in the pastry section. Actually, I don't really do this really justice because I love doing it. I had great joy of working in the pastry section. I had so much joy that I wanted to just stay doing pastries. And I love working with dough. I love the sensuality of it. It's the only section in the kitchen where you really get to massage your food for a very long time. And
how many kale massagers are there out in the audience?
It's fantastic. And I used to make pain au chocolat a lot. Mm-hmm. And there is this, you need to roll your dough and then you pipe your chocolate and it's kind of into these long sausages that you roll on themselves and you need to twist it and get the air out and then roll it and then cut it. And it's everybody needs to make this once in their life to really get the whole idea of how wonderful it is to do. And I remember that very clearly, how I enjoyed doing that kind of movement. And it's extremely enjoyable, the kneading and the pulling and the rolling and all these kind of wonderful things.
So is there a pastry book in the works?
There is a possible pastry book. We haven't signed a contract with the publisher yet, so I can't say anything. But yeah, no, there will be a pastry book at some point, a sweet book.
Yeah.
Because my passion is there and we've got tons. And Ottolenghi stands for sweets in many people's minds because we have a massive pastry counter that I'm very proud of and we constantly renew and change. And also in this book there is a nice baking or sweet section that I think does kind of different things with sweets.
Well, one last question for me, and then I'm excited to hear what our audience has to ask you. And it has to do, in a way, it ties together with pastry and then this other question that we talked about earlier about classic recipes versus improvisation. I think it's in the Jerusalem cookbook where you have a recipe for babka. Babka being one of the great, really like one of the grandma recipes, I would say, the booby recipe. and I'm curious about your approach to that because you obviously have such a great love for pastry. And for those who don't know, babka is, how would you describe babka?
Babka is a yeasted cake from Eastern Europe, and it's there's different types of fillings, but the pastry itself is enriched with oil or butter, and then you roll in nuts or chocolate, or some people do it with cheese, and then you kind of there are different ways to also finish it as well, but the one in Jerusalem is kind of braided and then cut. You see it in lots of Eastern European and Jewish delis across the land.
So I was kind of surprised to see that recipe in the Jerusalem cookbook, only because I kept thinking, how are Yotam and Sami going to Ottolenghi a babka? Because in fact, it is there's a kind of ur sensation of cutting into a warm piece of babka that I didn't want to have a contemporary, you know, sort of flip on it. And in fact, you don't do that.
We don't do a twist, no.
So tell me about that.
Well, the babka, a bit like hummus, you don't play around with it. I have to say something about Israeli cuisine, which is really interesting because what happened, there wasn't such a thing as an Israeli cuisine not too long ago. I mean, there was like the cuisines of all the people that gathered there, and there was Palestinian food, but there was never such a thing as an Israeli cuisine. And it's only in the last 20 years, actually, since I left, that this has actually started. It's got nothing to do with that. that it started to form itself, because Israel is a very young country, and it's very interesting how this is kind of taking shape. And babka, and if people who know Jerusalem know that there's very few recipes from Eastern Europe in the book, and that's not got to do not because of the fact that there isn't Eastern European food in Jerusalem. It's just because Sami and I don't like it so much. So we say it quite out loud. I mean, that we do love certain things. We love our matzo balls and we love our chopped liver, but we don't like certain other things. And so a babka is really, really delicious. So what I noticed is that what we turned into Israeli food is actually the what I call the survival of the fittest, where the best food of every community kind of rises to the surface and becomes part of the
pantheon,
the pantheon of of Israeli cuisine. And that's why the food is so good, because you got the babka, which is probably the best thing that Polish Jews have ever produced. and then you've got this...
Isaac Bashevis Singer may argue with you on that, but...
And then you've got this hog, which is the chili paste that the Yemeni Jews brought with them, which is like better than sriracha. And then you got the hummus, which is the, you know, from Jews from Arab countries and Palestinian. And so we've got all those things. So the kind of the icons of Israeli food are the ones that I don't want to touch because they're so good. But then there are all the others that you can play. Definitely you don't touch a babka.
Great. Well, I'm sure some of you have questions or ideas or recipe hints or kitchen disasters you want to share with us. There's microphones on both sides.
We have microphones on each side. I'm just going to ask you to come out to the aisles and line up to ask your questions. I'll take the first question right here on your left. Hi.
Thanks for doing this. So I've heard a lot about bakers and chefs, and my understanding is that bakers traditionally are really precise people who like to measure and make things exactly because that's what makes it turn out perfectly, and that chefs are more improvisational. So it's interesting to hear that you like to do both. Can you comment on your observation of those personality traits and how they manifest in you?
Yeah, I think it's probably true. This stereotype works quite well. And I think that actually works quite well for me too, because I'm very precise, anal. And that's why I think the pastry department suited me for many years. And that's maybe why I'm a recipe tester and not running the kitchens like Sammy, because there is a sense of that precision really helps me. Not only in the kitchen, but we'll focus on that now. And I find it very reassuring that things could be measured and you can put them down and you know it's going to be there the same the next time. But these are two types of personalities, and cooks are so different from each other. Every cook has their own way of doing it, and each one does it very, very differently. And yeah, I'm definitely on the right side of the scale, and then there's other people on the other side of the scale. But those observations are probably right.
Over here on your right.
Hi, first of all, thank you for your cookbooks. It's been fun trying all the various recipes. My question is, as a tourist to London, which of your restaurants would you recommend? And it may be difficult, just as it would be difficult for me to choose which one of my children I love more.
Exactly.
But if I could only go to one, which would you recommend?
Okay, I mean, so you're an Ottolenghi virgin, and you want me to tell you where to stop you,
Yotam, from finishing that sentence.
I would say if you haven't been to any of the restaurants, you want to go to Ottolenghi in Islington on Upper Street, because it does both the deli. I think that it's nice to see the whole display of food, which is what got us to where we are today. So that you would see there, but also the food as it comes from the kitchen, so you get a mixture of a bit of everything.
All right, next question over here.
Hi there. What is your junk food guilty pleasure? What do you hide to eat?
Great question.
I don't do guilt so much.
You're going to have to leave the building, Yotam. we're revoking your card.
I don't have a card. That's quite a serious point. I can eat many things that I can have things that we wouldn't consider appropriate for a vegetable guru. But I can have I have instant ramen in my cupboard with lots of MSG that if I want to eat something quickly, I pour some boiling water and have that. I don't feel guilty about it. I really enjoy it. You should try it once. But maybe I'll put a recipe for that in one of my books.
There you go.
But I'm not a purist, and I don't live like that. I like to eat everything, and I sometimes would have junk food or a chocolate bar or cheap one or whatever. But I think it's quite important. Not, I don't get really kind of precious about these things. And that's it. But those instant noodles, I do like them.
On your right.
I was lucky enough in May to go to all four of your outlets. And the thing that struck me the most is in the delis, the display of the food is so incredible. I mean, it's just right there. So then you come back to the United States, and I've learned now the term is a sneeze guard.
Yeah, sneeze guards.
You are not required to have sneeze guards in?
Don't tell them. No, we're fighting this. We have the way it works is that I think England is one of the only countries that allows this for some reason, and we have very strict health and safety rules. But there is a special clause. It's very technical, under which we operate, which is called the hotel and bar and. Hotel and buffet clause, which allows you to put the food out for a little while, up to 3 hours or 2.5 hours without guard for people to help themselves. And that's how we make it work. But it's very, you know, when the food goes out, we take note of the time and the temperature, and then we come every half hour and check it, and we come back, and then it needs to be discarded if it's not there for too long. So it's a controlled risk that we're taking, and you couldn't do it here, but also the weather is quite good for that. It doesn't get very hot, and so we kind of manage to do that, but not with meat or fish or anything dangerous, just with your vegetables. Just to reassure everybody. This.
Next question on your left.
I was just wondering if you've considered opening a restaurant in the U.S. and perhaps maybe the Bay Area.
So I will answer with a story. Forgive the people who've already heard this. But a few years ago, I did a program about the food of Jerusalem for the BBC.
And cooking and your interest in ideas, philosophy, literature, that I read, I think your dissertation was something about the photographic image, which, if anything, you have helped popularize culinary photography in your books. Or was it really a departure, like a different side of your brain that you were exercising in front of the stove or at the pastry counter?
Initially, yes. I would say that I felt, like I said, I think I used the word liberated. It did feel like I'm doing something completely different. That in actual fact, it was really nice to use my hands and not use my mind. Mm-hmm. And that's the way I felt about it for quite a long time. But when I started writing books, everything changed again, because I ended up, you know, doing the stuff that I left behind, you know, thinking about what I was doing, trying to understand what it is, how I work, what I do. So try to put names to thoughts and to procedures, which was a little bit more like what I did when I was studying philosophy. So in the end, I went through a whole circle and came back to doing quite a lot of what I did before.
Right.
But now the subject matter is more, I feel closer to it now than I did to what I did at university.
Well, I noticed with this newest book, it's again concentrating on vegetable cookery, but the flavor profiles, I guess, have started to get depart from the Mediterranean and Middle Eastern and move slightly eastward,
yes.
Iran and India and South Asia. Tell me about how you discovered that, how intentional is that? Is that just where are you? Is your palate restless the way other people might be restless about the kind of writing that you do?
Yeah, it is restless. And some of it is because I want to, and some of it is because I have to. And when I say I have to, I only understood it a few months ago when I call it being the victim of my own success, that in a sense, there is a certain expectation from my recipes, and we were trying a piece.
What would you unpack that? Is that expectation?
I will unpack it with an example. We were cooking pea soup in the test kitchen. It was the spring, and it was a delicious pea soup, and we wanted to keep all the vibrancy of the red. So, you know, we chilled the peas very quickly, and it was fantastic. And everybody tasted it, and they said, "Oh, that's marvelous." But then someone said, because I've got a little team now working together on recipe testing, someone said, "But it's not very Ottolenghi." And then it dawned on me, and actually I think I knew it before, but I could put word to it, that actually there is a certain expectation from recipes, and I cannot ever go back to cooking anything that doesn't have that kind of wow intensity of, you know, you know, very strong flavors. And it, sometimes it's a problem. So I embrace it now. That's kind of what I do. I do the wow factor recipes.
So how did the pea soup recipe change?
The pea soup recipe ended up being having certain flavored croutons. We tore some bits of bread, and I added a tiny bit of water to them, and then we tossed them in a mix of spices. Because they were wet, they could absorb them, and then we roasted them in the oven, and there was one other thing. You know, I couldn't just have a crouton. It wasn't enough. But I think a couple of other little things.
So you've described your, a little bit, you've got a test kitchen now. It's like a full-time lab. This is to feed new books, and you still are doing your column for the, do you still do the vegetable?
The Guardian,
The Guardian. And is it still, it's a vegetable?
It's not vegetarian anymore, but it's still very vegetable focused, because that's what I like doing. And there's many vegetarian vegan recipes, but there's also meat and other animals.
They allow you to introduce
expanded my remit. I'm allowed to cook with meat now. I wasn't allowed for many years.
Can you tell the story of your first column?
Yes, I got many people were angered that a non-vegetarian got to write the vegetarian column for the Guardian. We're talking about the days where, or it's still somehow a little, sometimes a little bit like that, that vegetarianism was a religion or a cult, and if it wasn't one of us, how could it be that someone got to write the vegetarian columns? That was in the initial reaction, but I made it much worse when at my maybe column two or three that I made some kind of summery salad. I suggested to serve it with lamb chops from the barbecue, and my editor didn't notice, and it was a disaster. I mean, the amount of emails that I got, and then the Vegetarian Society debated whether they're allowed to publish my recipe in their magazine, even if they are vegetarian. They were really angry at me, so. That is kind of how I started my world of my engagement with vegetarianism. But I have to say that I think the world has really changed since then, and it doesn't feel like this anymore. It feels like many carnivores and omnivores are very happy to eat way more vegetables than they used to, and they're really kind of putting their heart in it. It's not like it used to be like some limp old bean sitting on the side of the plate, all gray and overcooked. All of a sudden, like the serious chefs, you know, not like me, but the ones that have stars and all the rest, they put vegetables on their menus at the top, and not in California, that has always been miles ahead of the rest of the world, but in London, in Paris, in New York. I mean, those are places where all of a sudden you go to a Michelin star restaurant, and it's like the first few dishes are all vegetables. And this is like was unthinkable at 10 or 15 years ago, and it's a marvelous thing.
I guess it must be partly people's understanding about diet, as well as the sustainability, how difficult it is to live sustainably with a heavy meat diet. But it's also about flavor, yes? I mean,
yes.
You have an extraordinary bounty with vegetables, which is what you've gotten to explore
here. This is the point that I was trying to make in the introduction to the book, because I think what it was, when I started to write vegetarian recipes for The Guardian, I thought that I will kind of exhaust my ideas after about 10 weeks. You know, I thought, how many vegetarian recipes can I actually come up with that are applicable and usable for home cooks and exciting? And that you were asking me before about the moving east, and I actually forgot to address that.
I forgot to remind you to address that, so thank you.
But I think one of the things that I discovered over the last few years, and that has a lot to do with traveling, because I realized that, in a sense, I started off from the heart of the Middle East, from Jerusalem, and then with time, through travels and reading and coming into contact with cooks, I realized that it kind of makes sense to move north and east to Turkey, to Persia, to Iraq, to India, and to Southeast Asia. And every step that I'm taking makes complete sense to me. Currently, especially in this book, I'm engaged with the wonderful cuisine of Iran, the Persian cooking, which is one of the richest food cultures there is. Not totally explored yet in the West, I don't think, but really kind of people are starting to understand. And if you have... there aren't any very good, many good Iranian restaurants, but all the good cooking is done at home. So if you have an Iranian friend, just grab onto them and make them cook for you, because they do make the most wonderful home food, like nothing else. And the Iranians are the champions of rice cooking, and I'm saying that like they beat the Japanese and everybody else. They make the best rice. And
in what way? Like what makes?
Because there is this process that involves parboiling, and then allowing the rice to cook in its own steam, it makes it for long grain rice. Let's like narrow it down a little bit. It's the best thing you can do with it, because every grain is separate, and the flavors kind of evolve very slowly over time if they put some stuff on the bottom. So it is really the most wonderful way to cook rice, and also obviously the famous tadiks, the crusty bottom, which is, you know, everybody loves so much. So this is a cuisine that really makes complete sense to me to move on to, because these are very similar ingredients to the ones we use in Palestinian and Israeli cooking, but taken one step further. So every time I discover a cuisine like that, I think like, oh my God, I've kind of won the lottery. There's a little bit more of what I was doing before, and it's that's how I like to move around.
So what your skill is, I think, though, in particular, is not just discovering and writing about these traditional cuisines, but also kind of doing these mashups, these contemporary incursions that allow one or two twists to make something new out of, let's say, as Jordan mentioned in her introduction, I think it's the first recipe in the new book, this tomato and pomegranate salad, which I made the other day because we're lucky we're in the shoulder season right now in the Bay Area. We have still great late summer, early fall tomatoes, and wow, pomegranate. So I thought, okay, I'm gonna make this delicious salad. And of course, I have to go down to the Middle Eastern market to find the pomegranate molasses. And I'm shaking my hand saying, that Ottolenghi is making me go out of
the way. I'm surprised you don't have it in your larder already.
Confessions. It doesn't go with cracked crab. And so I'm. But all by way of asking, how careful are you to, or do you care if you are pulling up or introducing what we might think of as difficult to find, or I don't want to use the word exotic, because they're not exotic in the cultures that they come from, but for typical Western pantries and larders, ingredients that aren't normally found.
So the first part of the question is putting together things like, you know, pushing the envelope with the recipes. And I take quite a lot of care when I do this, because I also have great respect for old food traditions. I think I have gotten myself into a lot of trouble recently with a hummus debate with a very beloved British food cookery writer, whose name I won't mention, who added yogurt to her hummus, and I got really upset, and I said something in an interview, and then the Daily Mail wrote that I attacked her, that's more about British journalism than about hummus, but. what I'm saying is that there is certain things that I find it very difficult to meddle with, and I would never dare try to change a traditional recipe that's been perfected over centuries, because I've got all the respect in the world for that. But I do like to borrow in a very kind of incremental way, the way I described to you, and add to a kind of in a modern context or in a current context ingredients. Like, so if I, let's just give a few examples from Persian cooking, the ingredients that I haven't maybe used 5 or 10 years ago, like barberries and dried limes, those are things that I think are easily incorporated into our daily cooking. I think it's kind of kosher to do that. You know, you can do that. There's certain things that I would never try to change. I mean, I would never try to turn things on their heads completely and do, you know, there's a lot, like I'll go back to what I feel like I've got the authority to talk about a little bit.
Yotam Ottolenghi, and I just want to take a survey. How many of you have made an Ottolenghi recipe? Excellent, that's amazing. We're actually at 100%. I like it, this is great. So maybe you've had this experience. It's one that I have. I cook out of his books all the time. And even though I know better, I still kind of have this feeling sometimes. I go to make a recipe for the first time, and I'm making it, and I'm committed, and I'm thinking, has he pushed this envelope too far? It's, you know, there's turmeric, black sesame seeds, and Parmesan together in a cauliflower recipe. Not so sure. Soba noodles, eggplant, and mango? But it all works. As your anxiety grows, you wonder, is this the day? Is this the day you're going to make an Ottolenghi recipe that doesn't work? And no, because without fail, you sit down and you're eating something spectacular and unexpected. It's a party in your mouth, and you know, you're just so in awe of his talent, and it grows and grows and grows. And Yotam is an amazing chef, an amazing cookbook author, and he's really an amazing person. He's truly one of the warmest, kindest, and most brilliant people I've ever had the pleasure of presenting. He owns an empire of spectacular restaurants in London, hosts wonderful shows for the BBC, traveling all around the Mediterranean, and is the author, as we all know, of Ottolenghi the Cookbook, Plenty and Jerusalem. He is here tonight to celebrate his newest book, Pleny More, sure to be your next favorite cookbook. Pleny More is brilliantly organized by cooking method, from ones you would think of, like steamed, braised, and roasted, to the ones you maybe don't, like tossed, cracked, and blanched. I'm not sure if that was supposed to say cracked. It's terrible. Terrible. All right. I don't. Yes, cracked. That was right. Like all of Yotam's books, this one is filled with brilliant combinations you would never think of yourself. There's a tomato and pomegranate salad in here that will knock your socks off. And as always, there are plenty of eggplant recipes. Yotam is joined in conversation tonight by one of our favorite interviewers, the Peabody and Emmy Award-winning documentarian and producer Peter Stein. So please join me to welcome Yotam Ottolenghi and Peter Stein.
That's Yotam, the handsome one. Welcome back to the Bay Area, Yotam.
Thank you. It's great to be here.
Jordan, thank you for those beautiful words.
Yeah, now I have to be really charming.
Oh, fake it, Yotam, fake it. It's so terrific to, first for me to get a chance to meet you, because like Jordan, I have enjoyed experimenting with your recipes, and your new book is chock full of extraordinary flavors and combinations. Parochially, I do want to say, apparently the last time you were here in San Francisco, the Giants were also in the World Series.
They won.
We want to have you back every year. And in fact, let's see, January is the Super Bowl. May is the Stanley Cup Finals. Okay, we got you. Have to have you scheduled. Thank you all for giving up your Giants Royals experience. We'll say nothing about what is going on. Some of you may be taping. But this is so not only an adult experience for you coming back to the Bay Area. I was so tickled to learn that when you were 10 years old, your parents, who were both academics, I guess your dad is a mathematician and
chemist.
And
my grandfather. So you're not getting it so wrong.
In the hard sciences, and your mother and an educator, yes, they spent a sabbatical year when you were 10 years old,
yeah.
And they came to.
I landed from the Middle East to Mill Valley, California, in 1977. And I was delighted to see color TV for the first time in my life, and a lot of other things that got me super excited. I really have very fond memories of the city and the Bay Area, and it's remarkable because I've really only spent a year here, but it was a very crucial year. I loved it. I went to school here. I learned English. Israel was very different then to the country that it is today. It really felt like coming from the third world to the first world, and I had the time of my life.
You're only 10 years old, so I don't know what your palate already was like, or whether you even can remember if you experienced
I knew my multiplication chart, mm-hmm. 12 by 12 times 12, I got ice cream from the teacher. She got me ice cream. And this never happened in a school in Israel, that you got ice cream. And and that was a real culinary highlight. And There was tons more. I mean, we used to go to Fisherman's Wharf and eat shrimps and fried seafood from a newspaper cone, and I will never forget that. It was just fantastic. You can't get seafood, or you couldn't in Israel when I was growing up. So that was kind of really special.
That's I'm sure.
And not kosher.
Yeah. Not at all. Well, being a San Francisco native, I always thought that, in fact, cracked crab was Shabbos dinner. sorry. I still appreciate it. Good Shabbos to all of you. I hope you enjoyed your cracked crab tonight. So, as a 10-year-old, you're experiencing new culinary experiences in San Francisco or in the Bay Area. But I'm curious, because you've really helped popularize and really have lifted not just vegetable cooking but Mediterranean flavors to new and unusual heights in your cooking. Where do you trace developing your palate? What are your deep taste memories, and have they evolved as you've grown?
I was very fortunate because I grew up in an environment that I think now people take for granted a bit more, but it wasn't the case, you know, 40 years ago when I was a child, that, you know, it was an extraordinary mix of food cultures and influences in the 70s and 80s in Jerusalem. And there was, at home, we had, you know, European, my parents are all from European traditions, my mom's from a German background and my dad from Italian background. And you can imagine we had really great food, and they both loved to cook. But out in the street, it was, you know, it was the heart of the Middle East, you know, with all the wonderful markets with the vegetables and the spices and the local restaurants, the Palestinian restaurants that are so fantastic. So it was kind of the best of all worlds, and I think this was a really good starting point for someone like me. I could really taste so much, and there was so much going on, and particularly. It's funny now because my cooking cannot be more remote than from Italian cooking. My dad is secretly, he would never say that because he's too nice, but he secretly thinks I use way too many ingredients. he always says that's very delicious, but I think he would have rather had like about half or one third of the ingredients of what the ones I've added. So it's a very different way of thinking. But you know, it's fantastic food, and these are fantastic food cultures. But I was one point with I was really lucky because there were not a lot of kids from Jewish Italian background. It's kind of a little bit unusual, and we used to have at school these days where children used to bring the food of their diaspora. Mm-hmm. And so, you know, I was so popular because all the kids with the gefilte fish would come to my pizza, and that was kind of, can you imagine how popular I was on those days?
So was your dad the primary cook in the house growing up?
Both cooked. Mm-hmm. Both my parents cooked, and they still do, and they did a great job because, you know, they're pretty adventurous in their cooking, both of them. So we really had kind of lots of everything really, really delicious. I feel quite almost embarrassed to say, but we had really great food all the time.
Yeah. the pangs of jealousy are out there for all of us. Even so, obviously your parents are tremendously proud of your career and so forth. I can only imagine that coming from fairly serious, intellectual, career-driven family as yours is, that your choice to cook for a living wasn't necessarily popular.
No. It didn't go down too well with my dad. And I think the problem was that it's two very different generations, and my father in particular was worried that I'm ditching an academic career in favor of something that is very dubious. And
share with us what you were.
I was studying at the university in Tel Aviv, literature and philosophy, and I was on my way to do a PhD, and I was working at the university as well. And it never crossed his mind that I would not become an academic. Mm-hmm. And I think it never crossed my mind until a certain age that I'm not going to become an academic. But there came a point where I felt very, that it wasn't really my choice. And if I had to choose, I might have not chosen that. And And I felt almost burdened by the intensity of the commitment in university. And I came to London and did a few courses at a culinary school. And it was.
Did you tell your parents you were doing that?
Yeah, I told my dad. I sent him I sent my parents my dissertation, and in it was a letter. in the letter, it said, this was before emails. And in the letter, it said that here's what I've done, and that's my work. And it was a really respectable dissertation on a serious subject. But now I'm taking a gap year, and I'm going to go to culinary school. And my dad called me like 5 minutes after he got the thing, and he said, "Are you sure you're doing the right thing?" And but he's a very gentle, nice person, so he didn't really get into conflict with me. But I think deep down inside, he was very worried. So I just went on and did it. But I think, and then when I turned 40, on my birthday, everybody stood up to wish me things for the future. And he said, "I just want to wish you that you never listen to my advice again." and that was really lovely and a good kind of closure.
Closure. Yeah. He sounds like a very loving man. Even if he doesn't like all the ingredients that you put into your dishes. is there a connection for you now looking back between your interest in
raw beef with that kind of drizzled on top, like a kind of a tartare?
Wow. I didn't mean to denigrate verjuice, which is an amazing ingredient. It's what makes Dijon mustard taste different from German kind of mustard. Mm-hmm. But tell us a little bit about what verjuice is, because you do champion
verjuice. Verjuice is actually a very old ingredient. Essentially, it's the juice of unripe grapes, and I think it's probably older than most of the condiments we've discussed so far. It's been around forever, but it was very popular in France in particular. It is still popular. It's used instead of vinegar. It's not quite as harsh to finish sauces, and it's been popularized recently by Australian cook called Maggie Beers, and she has her line of verjuice and sells it all over the world. And it's a really good ingredient. I use it, I reduce it quite a lot and add it to dressings. And when you reduce it, you get more sweetness and more acidity, a little bit like pomegranate molasses. Not really, but in kind of that family of flavors. And it's good for dressings, it's good for marinades, it's good to finish off sauces and stews and all sorts of wonderful things.
I love what you said about keeping anxiety out of the kitchen. because in fact, I think you're spot on with, we have a wonderful and embracing food culture, but it also sometimes comes with a certain amount of panic around whether you're following the right trends and so forth. Are you personally okay with people when they come up to you say, "Oh, I made your wonderful recipe, but of course I substituted the oregano for mint and the pomegranate, I didn't have that, so I put in walnut"?
Completely.
How?
Yeah. No, it's exactly what I said earlier. I think there is this, almost totalitarian understanding of how things should work. And I think nobody has that kind of knowledge of exactly how you should do it or not should do or shouldn't do things. So I'm very open to that. I do changes like that. If someone feels comfortable to do that, I'm very happy. And in actual fact, my recipes are very long, and they have a long list of ingredients. So if you omit one or two, it's not the end of the world. You know, it's
you heard it here first, folks.
it's still going to taste good, maybe not completely as I wanted it, but quite close. So I'm very happy to give that a literary freedom to interpret my recipes as people see right. I am very literal, so when I put the recipe down, I try to allow people to be able to cook it exactly as I did. This is why I go down to the eighth of a teaspoon, etc. But that's because I want people who don't want to improvise to be able to do it and achieve what I achieved. I also don't, when I test my recipes, I never use fancy ingredients. I go to the supermarket and buy actually the cheap version, because I want to make sure that if someone does that, they're still going to get a reasonably good result.
So this brings up something important, because supermarkets, at least in the U.S., some of them are notorious for sourcing their produce from all over. If it's, you know, if it's winter and you want blueberries, you're going to get them because they're grown in Argentina. And
yeah, it's
so
really,
can you talk a little bit about the tension between having a very bright and lively and diverse set of ingredients and flavors in your cooking versus local and sustainable agriculture?
There's no contradiction, really, in my mind. I mean, in my restaurants, we source our ingredients, you know, in what I call locally would be, you know, Britain, maybe France, which is, as you know, certain parts of France are as close as Scotland is, or Europe in general. I call it local, but we do try to use things seasonally, and I think it makes sense because it's more delicious to use things in season. And it pains me to see when you go to a supermarket and you get this asparagus from Peru throughout the year. Peru is further away from us than it is from you, but it's probably the same here. And I don't get it, and I don't enjoy it. But bringing all these ingredients that I'm talking about, it's got nothing to do with that. I mean, those are ingredients that you could grow in some places, and spices have always been traded and transferred all across the world. And I think using, you know, localism is a good thing in general, but it kind of makes sense to not go to the extreme also with that, because I know that a lot of restaurants in London, for instance, try to grow their own produce on their roofs and little gardens and allotments and this and that, and I've got a lot of sympathy for that. But sometimes either it comes at a price. You know, it's way more wasteful to grow those, you know, five leaves or whatever on your roof than it would to bring it from a farm in Devon. You know, it's a tokenism. So you need to kind of take it with a pinch of salt. How far you're going to take that idea of locality and whether it's practical to actually practice it. So, when I'm here in California, we're talking about a completely different world because you've got the weather and you've got the land. And we're talking about a tiny rainy island that doesn't really, not much grows on. So we have to make the best out of what we can.
Do you, in fact, I mean, I know you're on a book tour now. You probably don't have much time here. But if you had your druthers, would you spend time in the Bay Area to take a look at food trends or go to restaurants that you have heard about?
This is the worst book tour I've been to because I've got only one night in San Francisco. And it's painful for me too. But I won't be able to go and try all the new restaurants that I want to go and have. But every time I go to the Mission and I go all around San Francisco and I eat everywhere I can. And I won't get to do it this time, but I will be back.
Yeah, good. Speaking of restaurants, you now are you have a multifaceted empire, really. You're publishing, you're writing, you're delis and restaurants. And here in the Bay Area, something has come up recently where chefs and restaurants are really decrying the shortage of chefs. Cost of living is extremely high in the Bay Area, and I'm sure it's also extremely high in London. And even here, I think it was in today's San Francisco Chronicle where we're learning that a few restaurants are deciding to dispense with the notion of tipping in the American custom of somewhere between 15 and 20%, so that they can automatically add a 20% surcharge to their bills so that they can pay a living wage to all of their employees, including the bussers and the folks who are cooking in the back and not just the servers. Long way of asking you, do you face some of those same economic challenges in keeping restaurants open in a very, very busy and expensive city like London?
Yeah, it's very, very difficult. We have, housing prices have been really increasing tremendously in the last few years, and I know that cooks that come to—I mean, London is a place where people come and spend a few years and then move on if they're for chefs, that's normally the case, or waiters, and it's a huge problem. They can live sometimes you get like six people or seven people or eight people living in one apartment in order to kind of make it work for them, and it's difficult for me as a restaurateur and also for other people like me. And I know that
we are struggling. We're quite fortunate that I think there is a core of staff that stays, but there is the problem is that with the people, the periphery where people come and go, and then you do get a lot of problem. And also there's so many types of restaurants now, and so many of them around, then the chefs come and go very quickly. They go and they do their stage for 6 months or a year, and then they move on to the next one. So that turnover doesn't help keep the quality, and it takes a long. Sammy and I struggle constantly with the quality control. We're constantly checking and tasting and retraining our teams to make sure that it's always good.
For you, at this point in your career, where you've really found that being, in a way, a writer, an educator, a sort of champion of cooking, how important is having a restaurant in the constellation of your activities? Would it be okay for you to close them? I mean, obviously, maybe economically, they're very successful, but when you say that it's hard, it's a hard business to be in.
The restaurants are doing well. And I think all the aspects of what we're doing actually enhance each other. So I think we have it really good. we sell books, and that helps promote the restaurant, and vice versa. So it actually works really well together, hand in hand. I wouldn't think that one comes at the expense of the other, especially because of the way that the company is run. It's a partnership, so it's not just me and Sammy. There's a couple of other acting partners, so each one does their own thing. So we make sure that it kind of works for us. But they're doing all right.
Okay. So and in fact, it does seem that also in the U.S. that one of the templates for how to keep a sustainable operation going in the food world is to have these multifaceted enterprises where you're doing it.
It's very handy in other respects because we're talking about keeping people. We can move people around. I mean, it doesn't sound so good when I describe it like that. But in a way, you can give your team, your staff, more opportunity for change and diversity in their work. Mm-hmm. So, my test kitchen team are ex-chefs that have worked for 2, 3, 4 years and have had. They've wanted to move on, and then they join, and we do testing recipes. So it's a wonderful thing to do that is different and a little bit less hard work and more social hours. So that kind of also helps a bit.
Not that you're not busy enough, but I heard you ask the other day on another interview program, so what's next for you? But I was actually very curious about your response, which wasn't definitive, but you mentioned pastry, and I realized that pastry is, in a way, that was one of your real introductions to cooking, that your first culinary education was as a pastry chef. So can you talk a little bit about what you like about working with dough and pastry?
Oh yeah, no, yeah. Pastry was my first station. My first, when I started working in kitchens, I was so underqualified that the chef told me, go and help the pastry chef whip her egg whites. And it was in a French-styled restaurant, so there was a lot of souffles. So I was whipping a lot of egg whites and during service, and it doesn't take a PhD to whip egg whites. And so I did that for a little while, and it's hummus. And I can't stand all the beetroot hummus and this hummus and that hummus, because for me that's just not what it is. Call it a spread or a paste. But if it was someone else's food, I would say, like, who cares, But, so everybody has things that are very close to their heart, and you need to respect that.
One of the books that you co-authored with your business partner and friend Sami Tamimi is the Jerusalem Cookbook, and I'm wondering how many here have actually thrown like Jerusalem Cookbook parties. I know a lot of you have. It's a tremendous book. But I'm curious, two Jerusalemites, do you argue about what hummus is? Or should taste
Sammy
like?
And I?
Yes.
We are kind of, funnily enough, we don't really argue that much. We tend to agree. We have similar palates. And we've been working together for many years, and we're very close friends. And no, we don't argue. We kind of, Sammy also is a bit more reserved with his use of ingredients than I am. So he's a bit closer to my dad's camp. but still, well, maybe somewhere in the middle. But all in all, we kind of see eye to eye on most things. And as much as we like to get into debates or fights, but we never get a chance to do that.
So Sammy is one of your team now that's developing recipes. Take us through the process of how you develop a recipe.
So just I want to clarify, Sammy is not part of the team. The way Sammy and I work together now is that because there was the business was growing and the books are coming out and there's just a lot to do, we've separated a little bit the way we operate in the last few years. I've got the test kitchen, which is really mostly geared towards publication of books and recipes and playing around and fooling around with recipes. And Sammy is in charge of the kitchens, and he trains the chefs and works with them, etc. And we meet about once or twice a week and exchange ideas, because the recipes that we publish in the books are not really always suitable for restaurants and vice versa. So we created this separation, which works very well for us, but it allows quite a lot of creativity to be going in different directions, so that's our system. But in terms of the test kitchen, now we have a little team of about two people plus me, and we test recipes together. First of all, it allows us to test more recipes. It allows me to do less chopping and washing up than I used to do. And it's also a great way to create, because we bounce off each other and we come up with new ideas. And I find that it's really changed the way I think about food. There's always, at the end of every cooking session, there's always a tasting and a kind of a robust discussion. We get into real serious discussions about the food, up to that, to the eighth of a teaspoon of something. and it's really exciting to do, but I think it also works in terms of the recipe, because we kind of turn them on the head a million times before we actually put them to paper and publish them.
So you organized this book, as I think Jordan mentioned in her introduction, by technique of how you treat the vegetables. Raw, tossed, braised, cracked. There is
cracked is the eggs. Yeah, I just wanted to make this clear. It's actually the only recipe that's not a cooking technique. It's just, all the rest, that's true.
Why by technique rather than by food group or?
It goes to what I was saying earlier, and I think that we have kind of grown up, everybody, quite a lot with our relationship with vegetables, and I think many people, I'm sure many in this room would be able to tell you the difference between a kohlrabi and a celeriac and a Swede and a turnip. A Swede is rutabaga.
Thank you for that.
I feel there's a certain amount of maturity when it comes to vegetable now. And I wanted to draw the attention to a different aspect, and that's how we cook our vegetables, which I think is very important. I mean, obviously, I cook them in plenty and I cook them here, but in terms of how the vegetables, how I look at them, I try to get to understand what is the kind of versatility of vegetables that we sometimes overlook. And that has to do with the way we treat them and cook them. And I also try to redress the balance between vegetables and meat, because I think, in my opinion, there is a general understanding and respect to ways of cooking meat. You know, if you make a steak, you use the prime cuts, and if you are using the cheaper cuts, you're gonna make a stew. Mm-hmm.
And
also when you go to a restaurant, they ask you how you want your meat done, if it's a burger or a steak or whatever it is, and you tell them, and if it's not good, you send it back. And with vegetables, it doesn't exist. And I made this joke a couple of times before. I'll make it again. You don't return your cauliflower if it's overcooked. And
are you going to start a new trend? The restaurateurs are now shaking in their boots. They sent back the cauliflower.
Yeah, or at least ask me how I want my cauliflower done. We're taking this to an extreme, but I think it is very much the case that vegetables are much more versatile than we give them credit for, and you can achieve a lot by taking one vegetable, cauliflower for instance, and grilling it or steaming it or roasting it or deep frying it or shallow frying it or char grilling it. I mean, they're all ways of taking one thing and turning it into something else, and in a sense cauliflower is much more versatile than a steak, because you can do many more things to it, and it will be more forgiving. So that's what I was trying to do, and that's the kind of message, just to allow people to be a little bit less one-track minded when it comes to cooking vegetables and understand this versatility.
You have such an amazing palate, but I am curious, you're also human. Is there a...
you think that?
Is there a flavor, either vegetable or from the world of the animal kingdom, that you don't like? Or is that a failure of some palate imagination to have not?
You know? No, I do like almost everything. I like some things more than I like others. So I like cauliflower more than a broccoli. I know that's very controversial. That's going to be in the Daily Mail tomorrow. But
the Broccoli Council is filing a lawsuit as we speak.
And I can't eat durian. It's a smelly, stinky fruit from Southeast Asia. But I think there is no such thing as a vegetable that's not delicious because of what goes to what I said to you earlier. Even something which is relatively I don't want to hurt broccoli fans across the land, but it's not for me. It doesn't have the best flavor or texture. But even if you char grill it properly and add a nice infusion of oil and some anchovies, like you know the Italian way, it's fantastic. It's delicious. And so I don't see a point not liking any vegetable.
You've also been really. Imaginative in embracing, as we talked briefly earlier, new ingredients or exotic ingredients or ingredients that are simply new to your palate. You talked mm-hmm. about barberries and Iranian cuisine. Yeah. Are there any other sort of discoveries? And I kind of want this to move a little bit into this notion of food trends or food fads, yeah. because as in the culinary world that we live in the Bay Area, you know, we're all trying to keep up with the latest cuisine and restaurant and mashup and pop-up, and sort of sometimes I resent the fact of I've heard about verjuice now, and I don't know what it is, and I know I champion it in the book.
Yeah.
I know. So tell us about new ingredients and the problem of the fad.
First of all, I want to address the second bit of the question because I think there is a problem because people start becoming very anxious and they associate food with anxiety, and that's not a good thing. Cooking is very and eating is a very sensual experience, and that's what I discovered when I moved from academia to cooking. And going back to and adding an element of anxiety is not very helpful. And I think the dinner party circuit are really quite an anxious lot because they're always trying to outmaneuver their friend with a new ingredient or a new cuisine. And I'm saying that I know it's not good for my book sales, but I really believe that people should just chill out a little bit and not people want to cook. They haven't even finished mastering the food of Thailand and they're already moving to Burma, you know. it's like seriously, but I feel very strongly about that you really don't need to have that anxiety in your daily life. So I have some friends that invite me to dinner parties, and the best people I like going to is the ones that cook more or less the same thing every time, because you know you're going to get something delicious that was tried and tested, and that cook is kind of famous for it, like it used to be, and I find that a little bit more helpful than you know just the whole new thing every time. So that's about anxiety. Having said that, there's some wonderful ingredients that I do like championing and discovering and showing people. And some of the ingredients that I do love at the moment are the ones that we mentioned from Iran. Another one that comes from that part of the world is kashk, which is kashk or kishk. It's probably most of you have not heard about it. I'm quite new to it. It's a fermented yogurt that's been allowed to dry. And when you go in Jerusalem in the Old City, sometimes you see in the shops these balls of white rocks. They look like white rocks. I always actually thought it was soap, and actually it's dried yogurt. And because you know when there was a season, there used to be a season for milk. So they'd make the yogurt all around in Turkey, Iran, Palestine, and then allow it to dry in the sun. sometimes with barley, sometimes with wheat, and as it would dry, it would ferment, and then that when it's completely dry, they'd make it into balls, or say keep it in as powder. And then when the time comes to use it, you rehydrate it with a bit of water. And it's got a wonderful flavor. It's a bit like kind of a really mature Parmesan and from the process. And I've been using it. It's very hard to get. In London, we get it from Persian shops in jars, rehydrated already. It's very nice. As a substitute, I mix Parmesan, feta, and sour cream. And that kind of flavor combination reminds me of that.
And you use it as an additional ingredient in what kinds of dishes?
So, for instance, it's a really good way to finish stews. Like, you could drizzle it on top. You need to warm it up a bit to kill the bacteria. But it goes over. No, I didn't mean that in the way it sounded. that's really good. Also, any context you'd use yogurt and cheese, it comes in handy. Okay. We even had a dish at Nopi in one of my restaurants.